the seventh day, God ceased from all that was completed, and he said, let's celebrate together. So he's saying that you're supposed to enter in to him into a mindset and a heart and a life that is in the living God's presence on the Sabbath day, which is a day of celebration between you and God. Not supposed to be a celebration of man to man. It's supposed to be a celebration with you and God. Why? Because God's the one celebrating. It says in the Hebrew, he sat down and celebrated. That's what he called rest. I submit to you, our English language crucifies the truth out of that. The truth of it is he rejoiced in everything that he did and feasted and celebrated over the accomplishments of everything he had done with his hand. And so he's saying then, there remains then a Sabbath rest for God's people. There remains then a place in the land, a place in God's presence, a place that's holy and sanctified. Matter of fact, he said, this seventh day is so important to me. I command every generation and every nation from now on, this day is holy. This day is sanctified. This day is honored before me. This is my day. This is a day that everything is completed, that all mankind will celebrate from now on, and I give you that charge. Before any law was ever written, he made that declaration about the Sabbath. Food for thought for you. But we're not just talking about a Sabbath. We're talking about he has selected a day that you're supposed to enter into that Sabbath rest. Doesn't say anything about coming out of it. A day that you're supposed to enter into it. Now, once the children of Israel entered into the land, the only way they could be expelled from the land is do what the people did that were in there. He said, if you do these things, you'll be thrown out too. Why? God's still making clear to them, it's my land, and I'm allowing you to live on it. I'm going to give it to you as inheritance, and if you squander your inheritance, I'll take it away from you. So, there remains then a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For anyone who enters God's rest also rests from his own works, just as God did from his. You catch that? Are you resting from your own works? Are you going to fix yourself? Or are you going to, anything you do in your mind's eye through philosophy, through your own understanding, will not get you into God's presence. You are going to have to come to the conclusion, I've got to throw my instructions away and I've got to do it his way. I need his instruction. Elsewise, everything you do, you're doing it. If you're trying to like life more spiritual instead of doing what God says to do, then you're doing it and you have to cease. God's giving us a cease and desist order from being religious. He has given us already instructions to seek him with all of our heart, mind, soul, and body, and not to build our life in anything but him. But I would submit to you, we're good Samaritans. We want to build all kinds of temples out in the desert and up on high hills and in places we choose so that we can be our own authority and still deceive ourselves that we belong to him or are directed by him. Therefore, let us therefore make every effort to enter into that rest. Are you making an effort for that, or are you making an effort to gain life in this life? You remember I started out, I said if you want to keep your life, you'll lose it. But if you're willing to lose your life and be in the presence of your God, then you'll find it. So that no one will fall by the following of their example of disobedience. What was the example that God gave them to us for, type and shadow? He said they didn't enter the land because they wouldn't do it my way. Our God set up in the desert and he looked at the people and he said, look, I got a land flowing with milk and honey. I'm going to build something down here that's a type and shadow of what's up there. It's going to be a bunch of sheets hanging in the wind to those who don't believe. But to those who believe, they'll see my great presence behind it. I don't want it built any other way than the way I'm instructing you to build it. I'll not accept any substitutes in any form, in its design, in its functionality. I'll not take one word changed from you. I want no input from you. It is for me. It is a receptacle, but my presence will come down and sit and stand. And I'll, one theologian said, God no longer would have to commute. He would be here on earth and resident on earth. Man's disobedience. Instead of blue uniforms, somebody would probably pipe up and say, we want purple, we want pink, we want yellow. Instead of a silver wire around the top, I think it should be gold. Instead of cherubims on the walls, we'd probably paint Mickey Mouse's in there and make Walt Disney World out of it. And my point in making these utterances, God instructed the uniforms were supposed to be blue. Instructed all his priests, they were to cut their hair once a month. Instructed all of his priests, exactly even down to the undergarments, of what they would wear and when they would bathe and when they would shave and when they would stand in his presence and how he would stand in his presence. He gave them the most detailed instructions that have ever been given so that they could walk in his presence. If they changed one of them, he would not show up. If they changed one of them, they could not go on out of the desert, for they tried. They tried changing and changing and changing and tried it every different way that there was, but God said no. My whole point in the exercise of what we want to go to is to give you a demonstration. We have to do it God's way if we want to enter that promised land that's flowing with milk and honey. Milk of the Word is one form when he says milk and honey. The honey, boy, that's something even greater. Do you realize Old Testament passage scripture? And even in the New Testament. God writes out a scroll. Writes it. He's not only said it, he writes it down. He tells somebody, eat this. It tasted sweeter than honey. I would submit to you the two forms of word that is given. One, the milk of the word of what he has said. But the other is the honey. That's what he is saying and what he writes down that can enter into us. And that's firsthand. If God handed a little note to you and pinned it to your chest, I'll tell you that would be a treasure to pass around. If Jesus Christ wrote one excuse note. Do you know what an excuse note is? I was late, I was tardy, I did it my way, and I need an excuse. My mom writes one for me, and I go to school. What would it be like if you had an excuse note that Jesus wrote? I'd probably wear several of those. Dear Father, please excuse this moron. Dear Father, please excuse him. He's out of sorts today. Dear Father, please overlook his rashness and his haughtiness. Our Jesus does not make excuses for us. He paid the penalty. So he can say, please excuse. He paid the price. Now, I've given you this and these different things so you can understand that God himself, through the Holy Spirit, ties in Joshua right in the midst of this as the replacement of Moses, and that the children of Israel were to follow into the land. Moses, he's the type and shadow. He got them right up to the river. And he stepped out of the scene. Then God sends another on the scene, that his mighty warrior, Joshua. And Joshua leads them into the promised land. The type and shadow, Jesus, shows up on the scene, rescues us, takes us out of Egypt, puts his blood upon us, takes us to the point of crossing through the barrier of the veil, into the Father's presence, and then he steps out of the picture with us on this side of the veil. And then who shows up to escort us? The Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is a type of Joshua to lead us through the land. And the land is filled with giants, don't forget. I would submit to you, what does God want to populate with His presence? You, your heart, your mind. Where does God's temple at? Inside you. So there's obstacles to prevent us from taking the land that belongs to God that's wrapped between your ears. Do you see the land that's offered for you to take? Your life. There's all kinds of giants. And the first giants that the Israelites had to face, the Anak. The first thing that God sends them to, He sends them up and around and drops down into a valley that's nearly 1,000 feet below sea level, next to the Salton Sea, or the Great Sea, Araba in the Hebrew, a place of salt. But they're up in a little fertile valley above that. And when they dropped into that valley, which was to be part of Israel, manna stopped, and they had crops to eat for the first time in 40 years. But now they've got to cross the river. And Joshua just been anointed by Moses. Moses went up, and he disappears, and they can't find his grave, and Satan is up there disputing with Michael. And I'm sure if Satan and Michael are in a dispute about something, it's no small thing. Satan has come after the body of Moses. And Michael says, "The Lord rebuke you." He wins. Boy, it's a big battle, isn't it? I'm glad we got Michael on our side, but I'm telling you, our Lord Jesus didn't even have to say, "I rebuke you." It's all Michael had to say. "The Lord rebuke you, Satan." He didn't get in any argument with him. Didn't have to. He had to be rebuked by Jesus, by God Himself, and was. Now, my point in being is they're on this side of the river. And now they have to make a decision, and they make the decision. They begin to make declarations to Joshua that they would follow. They made the declarations to him just like they made them to Moses. "Whatever you say, we'll do. If you say move, we'll move. If you say fight, we'll fight. If you say this, we'll do it." Finally, there's a people that's obedient. Isn't that something? When the whole people become obedient, they get to cross the river together. Isn't that cool? That thought process just slays me. Because if we want to live in God's presence, His manifest presence, and have these real experiences, and not hear long distance, not hear about experiences that someone else had, but live in a land of peace where God subdues our enemies, a land that our children can grow up in God's presence, a land that our children can have experiences with living God that walks in it, a land that we daily encounter and eat from His vines, from His vineyards. You realize God gave them a land that was full of vineyards, full of houses. They didn't have to build anything. Now, when they had left Egypt, they were probably 1.5 million people in some accounts, some 2 million. God says He blessed them and multiplied them 1,000 times. I take Him serious as His word. And there is a lot of people waiting to cross. And Joshua finally tells him, he said, here's what the Lord said. You're going to see Him do something great today. You priest, you pick up the ark, and when you walk out into the river, see what your God does. They walked out of the river, and it's full flood stage. It's probably 2 miles wide. It's got within it, not in flood stage, this river has over 20 million cubic feet of water that goes by every minute when it's not in flood stage. That's a lot of water. And when it is in flood stage, I don't know. I didn't take time to calculate that out. I was just reading what the scientists already know of what it does today. And it's a much more arid area than it was then. But why would God make them cross right there? And what is God trying to say in the shadows and types and symbols? Where is he sending them to? He's sending them across into a valley that's right above this place. If you go further up that valley, there's a place called Adama in the Hebrew, which means city of Adam. And when God's presence went out into the river stopped immediately, and the ground was dry right under the priest, and the river, you could see it from probably 10 miles away, growing into a giant mountain being held back. But the scripture records, and they walk across on dry ground, and the kings of the Amorites and the Hittites and the Canaanites and the Philistines are just, it says that their hearts fainted seeing what God did, and they're coming. This is an army of million coming, a million man army coming across at you. I find it interesting that God sends them to the oldest city on earth. Historians account it that it dates back over 9,000 years. Now, it hadn't been 9,000 years since the flood, so I think who missed it? But they account it that it 6,800 years ago, it was the first fortified city in the world. But 9,000 years ago, it was a thriving city. It was a city of wealth. It's a city that's 800 feet below sea level. And as such, it has a subterranean atmosphere that plants grow wild in. It stays a kind of a constant temperature. I don't know if you've ever been down the bottom of Grand Canyon. Jackie has, and she says it's just almost a constant temperature down there. So there's this constant temperature, and there's springs flowing out of the sides of the mountain. And I think it was Eli-in Sultan that built that fortress 6,800 years ago. I think this represents the type and shadow of the oldness of us, the old man, the fortified city. Before anything else was fortified on earth, this was the fortified place. Fortified from what? Fortified by whom? I can tell you that it was conquered several times and it became part of the early Babylonian Empire. It was rebuilt 5 different times. I can tell you that it was part of the Egyptian Empire. They had went in and subdued the Canaanites about 150 years before the Israelites showed up. Excuse me, they ruled it 150 years before the Israelites showed up. They had subdued it. It had gained so much power that the Egyptians lost their power over it and lost their power over all the kings of the Canaanites that was there. This place was the main trade place for Europe for salt, one of the most precious commodities on earth. It was rich in salt, which was worth millions of dollars because there was places that there was no salt. It was guarded as a result, the way to it and the way in it and the way out of it, because of its steep walls and canyons around. It was a guarded place. It was also a place of pitch, which was also probably the second rarest commodity on planet Earth. It was known as the City of Palms, and it was irrigated for some 22 miles wide and 70, 80 miles going to the north along the Jordan on both sides. God sends an army to take down the blockage of the oldness within us. Do you realize that after we walk with God a while, and after we learn His ways, after we learn to participate in things of the Spirit, after we learn His instructions, there comes a day that we're supposed to try to enter into the presence of God, but if we're going to do so, we have to attack the giant walls in our lives. We have to check the well-fortified thing that is hiding sin within was Balaam. You remember the prophet that sold out. It is said that when the walls collapsed and they killed everyone in that city, that Balaam was in there, and they found him in a room full of gold that he had been paid for telling the king of how to defeat the Israelites. The only surviving person in that wicked place was a whore, a prostitute. And why? Because she had hid the spies in her home. Let's translate that. We're nothing but a prostitute in this life when we stand next to the living God. The only thing worthy of saving within our high towers, within our haughtiness, within our self-willness, within the sets of double walls. This city had a double wall, and the inside wall was wide enough that it had houses built on it. There was like 35 feet between the two walls, so an opposing army would have to come up, climb over one wall, and they'd be cut to pieces with arrows before they ever even started the ascent of the second wall. But God says, I want to do something different here. I want you to understand, if there's going to be change in you, you're going to have to be a bearer and a carrier of my presence. And with my presence and the proper in authorities attached to it, I want you to take 7 trumpeters and you put them in front of my ark. I don't want you to do anything. I want you to keep your mouth shut. I want you to walk around this city once a day for 6 days. But during that 6 days, there better not even be a whisper off your lip nor voice heard. I don't want to hear anything but 7 trumpets blowing as they go around the city, and you only go around it once today. They get up, second day, you go around it and do the same thing. Don't talk. Keep your mouth shut. See what your God does. Third day, you get up again with God's presence. The army goes before. That's what we know. That's what we've been already equipped with, is supposed to go to carry and maintain God's presence and let Him deal with what's inside. Let Him deal of how to get through the walls. But the trumpets have to blow. And I don't know if you know this or not, there's the 7 trumpets that it's talking about is the same 7 trumpets that are let go in the book of Revelation, that bring the whole walls of this earth crumbling down and release every plague that there is and every judgment of God. It's us who have finally learned how to walk in God's presence enough that His trumpets alone can take care of the walls of our lives and can collapse those things inward, where the spirit man now can go rushing in and not let one thing live in our unfaithfulness towards God. Not let one thing live of our flesh man that hides inside the Jericho of the old man. I submit to you, we have not taken the 6 days to walk around this city. Instead, we guard this city. That's the first thing that they did, the people in Jericho. They guarded it. When God starts talking to you about your flesh, when He starts talking to you about your wicked ways, we guard it. We put a double wall around it. We say, oh God, we want to enter into your presence. We said, well, to enter into it, we've got to get it out of the land. Disobedience is no longer an option. We have to crush all disobedience of the past. We have to crush the mindset of the past. We have to crush the wickedness of the past. Now, I told you this was a wicked, cursed place. Not the place, the people in it. Noah, when he gets off the boat, his youngest son, Ham, and Canaan. Canaan goes in, and Ham goes in, and he looks upon his father after his father has drank wine and sees his nakedness. Noah gets up the next morning and realizes his son did that. His other two sons, instead of looking up on their father's nakedness, they backed in with a quilt backwards, looking at each other to make sure they're a witness of each other that they didn't look upon their father, and lay a quilt over him and then exit out the tent. And when Noah got up, he called him in and he said, "Cursed is Canaan. Cursed is him. He'll be a servant to his brothers." And he starts naming off. I don't know if you realize it or not, but Canaan's ancestry is the one that possessed this land. A people that liked to look upon immorality, hence Sodom and Gomorrah. A people that like to look upon impurities, and God wants to deal with the secret mind and the secret heart that's locked up in the Jericho inside us of the old world, and saying, it's inside the heart that matters. My spirit has come to cut asunder the thought from the intent and finally get to the depths of your Jericho. Are you willing to carry my presence around this and keep it encircled until the walls collapse and you can deal with these things and let nothing live? I find it interesting that God would pick this place. Why? Because it was a defender of all of Israel. It was a defender of rights of all the darkness contained therein. It was one of the cities, when the other cities of Sodom and Gomorrah were carried off, there's no mention of this place. There's not any nation alive that would attack this place. But they were the defenders of all the interior. I would submit our flesh man, the defender of the darkness that lies within, that keeps us from entering the land. God wants to train you to tear down your Jericho. On the seventh day when God is present, on the seventh day that you spent with him next to the edge of your darkness and looking at your darkness, carrying God's presence, shaking your fist at it, saying, God will overcome you. God will take the walls down. Josh is saying, be valiant. Your God will do this. We don't seem to trust our God that he can take care of the inner darkness within us. He'll set the prostitute free and give us a place in the land. We'll have to admit what we are. We're not anything religious in the land. Our God is what sanctifies us. Our God is what rescues us. But she hid the spies. And I tell you, God spies. It's his mighty word that he sent into your heart. Have you hidden his word in your heart? His spirit is in there telling God everything goes on within you. His spirit examines your thoughts and your minds and your precepts. I hope this is not too much of a complex maze for you to understand that God is still dealing in symbols. I think one of the greatest symbols that there is in Scripture lies within the mysteries of this, of us, how to enter the land of God. I think we must realize we are Jericho. We are God's enemy, the flesh man that resists him. But if I learn his ways in the desert, if I learn to be obedient to him, and I learn to carry his presence properly the way he wants it done, that's why I had to learn how to get a haircut once a month, why I had to learn how to wear blue, why I had to learn how to play a trumpet, why I had to learn how to walk in succession, why I had to learn how to carry the Ark of the Tabernacle, why I had to carry God's presence, why I had to learn these things. And so when I cross the river and when I want to live in the land with God, I can carry his presence, and his presence will take down these things. There's things in your life that you can't take down. You need to just surrender in the desert to your God and learn to be a carrier of his presence in absolute obedience. If you learn to be a carrier of his presence, he will give you instructions. Because when it came the seventh day, Joshua now spoke, and guess what? This is the Sabbath. This is the Sabbath day. The first Sabbath day to take place there. And guess what God is doing? Disinfecting it. Oh, how I need him to do that. Because those trumpets, they walked around the city seven times with God's presence on that day. If we learn to carry his presence and keep ourselves so surrounded and Jericho surrounded, then the walls would collapse inwardly. and the thousands and thousands of soldiers that are standing on top of the walls would be buried with it, buried in between the walls. And then we could run through and dislodge and strip every room and burn the city to the ground so that nothing is left there and nothing will be taken there. Nothing was supposed to be taken from this place. Everything in it was cursed with the exception of the bronze, the iron, the gold, and the silver. Everything had to die within it. There's nothing of our old man that we can carry out in the land if we're going to live in the promised land with God. Not one thing. And we have to become willing agents of our living God and soldiers in his army. He told them, he said, I want all women, men, and children, you stay on this side of the river. And I want you to know, every man, jack of you that crosses the river, we're going in to clear the land for God. And we're not stopping until it's cleared. And you won't get your inheritance until the land is cleared. And there's the problem. We're trying to claim the inheritance without clearing the land. And the only obstacle in the land is the giants that we have accumulated that give us our defense package. The giants in the land that give us our rights to fight and hiss and bite and curse and do every manner of foul thing and claim our own way. I just carry my presence. I can take that giant down. I can take the walls of your old nature down and level it. And make a clear path right over the rubble, right up into the great city that I want to build upon the hill called Jerusalem, where you'll be walking in my divine presence and not just have to carry me. Pray to God that you learn how to take down Jericho, because we cannot possess the land unless we do. Shall we pray? Lord, only you can hide this message within our hearts. Only you can show us about how we have connived with the enemy. We desire so much to cross the river and be circumcised into total obedience. We desire to walk in the land with you. But we have not yet conquered it. We ask you for your assistance. We want to be trained in ways of hearing. We want to be trained so much that our heart says yes to any instruction you have to give us, and that we do not resist it. It's the only way that we would be equipped to carry your presence and sustain carrying your presence for the days that it takes to bring down the great walls of Jericho that are within us. How we need to be delivered. How we need to be crushed and ground to powder so that nothing is left of our evil ways and our wickedness. Help us in this, Lord. I take confidence that you will. Train us in this, Lord. I take joy that you will. And I praise you. In Jesus' precious name. Amen. 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 Your notes consist of scriptures that I used. Consist of anything else. I hope that you take time to look them over. Not now. But right now is the time for your response to your God. If he's been speaking to you and he's revealed anything to you, and today, if you have heard his voice, don't harden your heart. Receive his instructions. How did he speak to you? We'll have the microphone ready to pass around. Let's bow our hearts. You raise your hand as God speaks to you of what he spoke to you in the midst of this. of proclamation would you make before your Lord? What cry would you make before Him? Ball's in your court.
It seems like every time I feel like I'm doing okay, that old flesh man starts rebuilding those walls of Jericho. And it's so hard for me to tear them back down again. And Father, I just pray that You'll help me. Blow those trumpets, Lord. And help me walk a closer walk with You.
Lord, do You hear my brother's heart to cry? Show him how to become Your priest so that he can carry Your presence to encircle His Jericho. Show him how to train as a priest so he can blow Your trumpets and see You do these mighty things. Anyone else?
Lord, I know there's walls. I know there are. And as You've been speaking to me for the last 2 weeks about putting certain things before You, there's nothing that I hold in my life that You do not see. And I welcome You. I welcome You to help me, to teach me how to bring these walls down. Every thought into obedience to You, that You might be the victor in all of it. Father, I trust You. Holy Spirit, I give You permission. I invite You to come. I invite You to work the work in me that needs to be done, that I might be a glory and a praise to Your name, Lord Jesus. Thank You. Thank You for this timely message.
I too find this to be a really timely message. I've been praying for direction and what am I supposed to do now, you know. And I had a revelation of sorts that I'm supposed to be surrounding my city of Jericho with God's word and His presence until it collapses. And I think through the gift of an MP3 player recently that might happen now. So thank You.
Amen.
Father, I just think that I feel like You've brought me to the walls of Jericho, Lord, just to show me how small I am without You. And I think sometimes I see my giants, Lord, as impossible, but Lord, I know that all things are possible with You, Lord. Father, I just ask that You would give me the strength that I need to tear down the walls and to destroy the giants in my life, Lord.
Lord, I just love this picture, this whole, I just love the fact that you speak to us through tops and shadows, and I'm so thankful for this clarification of what the type and shadow of the promised land and the wilderness and Jericho and all of these things are. Lord, I feel like that you dealt with my Jericho years ago, and I feel confident that that through your power of your spirit I've been able to keep it in rubbles. But Lord, if I extend this type and shadow throughout the rest of the history of the children of Israel and see how the other places that they had to conquer and the other things they had to accomplish and the and even how they finally gave up chasing out some of the guys because they were such pests and they wanted to get busy about just living their lives and harvesting their crops and doing all those things, and how they got lazy about and diligent. They didn't stay diligent with keeping out the enemy and dealing with them properly. And Lord, I can see that in my own life. There's some areas where I have just gotten lazy, Lord. So Father, please forgive me. I do want to take the entire land, and I don't think the children of Israel ever accomplished it. But Lord, I want to accomplish that. I want to finish that race. I want to keep that goal ever before me, Lord, just like Paul said. So Father, give me the endurance and the strength, the ability, the wisdom, the insight. Lord, help me to understand, because each and every area that you had them take, I see now that they took differently. There's a different process that you would have them walk in and overcome. So, Holy Spirit, I just ask that you would just lead me in that too, just as you led the children of Israel. Thank you for this wonderful picture. It makes it so much more attainable somehow, or real somehow. So thank you.
Anyone else?
Lord God, I'm coming to see that I'm still in many respects in the wilderness, and you're trying to teach me, Lord. And I'm still afraid to see you face to face, Lord. But I hear you. I hear your lessons for me of patience and reverence, Lord. Lord, teach me to live in those things. Teach me to live in your word. Thank you, Lord.
Father, I'm so deeply impressed. Everything that has occurred in my life today has been explained to me in this sermon, in this message. Today you gave me instructions about the importance of the Sabbath and the importance of your detailed instructions in our lives. Not just my life, not personal instructions, but your specific instructions to us. And I repented all day, Lord, of my casual handling of your instructions. Still not fully understanding what was being brought forward. And then tonight when we were worshiping, I heard this sentence, "Arise to your rest." And I went, "What is your rest, Lord? Aren't you already in rest? What is your rest? And then I heard it explained in the sermon. That's God's celebration of it is good on the Sabbath. So, Father, I feel so inadequate. Yet, I saw in the notes that our house is built with faith and hope and courage. And I want to say to you, okay, I hear you. My goodness, from dawn to dusk, pay attention. I hear you. Please forgive me and hold on to me so I can walk across the broken walls with you that you showed me during worship. How amazing that you are so specific with us. Please receive this prayer in Jesus' name, my God.
Anyone else? Orla Mae, after Tammy.
Father, I just thank you for clearing some things up for me. Lord, thank you that even though my rebellion places me in the wilderness, in a desert place, but you use that same wilderness to mature me and to grow me and to draw me closer into a walk in your presence, Father. I pray, Lord, that you would help me to identify the places in my heart that I have fortified and the places in my heart that have become hard because of the deceitfulness of sin in my life. Father, I ask you to help me tear that down, Lord, and so that I can be in a closer relationship with you, so that I can realize the comfort of being in your presence, no matter what I'm doing or where I'm at. Lord, I just desire to move on into a place of maturity in you, in your spirit, and Lord, I thank you for this word tonight and for bringing clarity to my mind and my spirit with this message. I thank you in Jesus' name.
Lord, I just thank you for the hope you placed in my heart today and for then giving me this picture of Rahab. Because of her decision, you put hope in her heart and a promise even before the walls came down. And Lord, you've done the same thing for me today, and I thank you for that.
Lord, I want to thank you for the wondrous ways in which you work and how you must love mystery and sharing the mysteries with your people. I'm so amazed that tonight listening how many times you've told me in the last 6 weeks to be still, to be quiet and watch and see what you do, to not do anything but watch you, to be aware of the giants. And you've shown me some giants in my life and then told me to watch and be still and watch and see what you do, and to be filled with your word, to be filled with your spirit, and to watch you, to be still, to listen over and over again. And I have seen you do wonderful things I couldn't have accomplished in a lifetime of trying. I praise you. Thank you for this word. Lord, bless it somehow. Bless the word to each one of us. Somehow, Lord, help us to open our hearts and our spirits to it so that you can touch each part of us, each one of us, where we need to be touched. And help us to not forget in our spirits what you've told us, what you've shared with us tonight. Thank you, Lord.
Anyone else? Last call. Last call. Tristan.
Lord, I thank you for all the different ways that you spoke to me too tonight, Lord. Like so many other people here, I recognize that I have a very well-fortified city, and I'm powerless to tear it down with my own hands, with my own skill, Lord. And so I ask that you'd strengthen me and equip me in your presence, Lord, to be able to carry your presence. It's the only thing that'll tear it down, Lord. I feel like an absolute Canaanite, Lord, an absolute Canaan who beheld wickedness, Lord, and was okay with that. For the ways that I've entertained wickedness in my thinking and rebellion in my heart, Lord, I ask for your forgiveness, Lord. I, like the children of Israel, when they were in the wilderness, the enemies they were facing weren't really enemies outside of themselves, Lord. And I feel like one on the threshold of going into the land, and now I'm starting to have to deal with enemies that, in addition to myself, Lord, but more the attacks of the enemy, and I don't feel entirely equipped to handle them, Lord. The giants are big, and I'm like a grasshopper in their sight, Lord. And so I ask for your strength. I ask for your presence, Lord. I ask for your forgiveness and your help, Lord. Thank you.
Anyone else?
I just have a little P.S. What a joy it's been to move out of individuality and solitude and places where I've not been in community, and to move into community and to find out tonight. This is how we'll move forward, is together in unity. And what a tremendous joy, and I give you thanks, Lord.
I find it interesting that it had two walls, or I think it had two as symbolic of us trying to take Jericho down. We just moved the bricks from one wall to make it shorter, but we're stacking them on the other. I find it interesting that the religious man that wanted to gain riches by using God hides in there. There's many men that want gain in this world and just betterment in this world. That's all they want to use God for. He was hiding in there. I find it joyful that he rescued the harlot. Because we're no better than that. If we keep our minds at that lowly of come and rescue me, O God, break down the walls, our God will rescue us. She had specific instructions. Make sure stay in your house. She'd taken the spies of God into her home. If you take the living presence of God into where you're at, he'll give you some instructions too. He wants to train you in the desert to be obedient. Are you tired of his training? The day that you decide to accept his instruction over yours, you might be finding yourself encamped, ready to cross the river. Doesn't have to be a long time. Has to be a heart change of your will, O Lord, not mine. God richly bless you. I pray that he's touched your heart with all the shadows and types that he gives us, and how great he is to give us a land, to promise us that we can walk with him in this real kingdom of God, to have real experiences and cross into it, to live in it, not just to pop in and pop out. Children of Israel in the desert had many pop-ins and pop-outs. But be sustained is something in the presence of God in a land, in a real land that God walks in. Revelational, experiential, life in God, he wants you to have. Shall we pray? Lord, I ask you to help hide your word deep within us. For we are people that like to change what you say and not abide by it. So forgive us, Lord. And hide these truths so that the enemy doesn't give us other training. We want to become your obedient people. That is our desire, Lord. Train us. We will submit to your instructions. Not only submit, but run after and thirst for and desire and long for. Are they the only thing that we can acquire from you that will enable us to conquer the land to live in it? That's why you said that we would be much more than a conqueror in you. In Jesus' name, I praise you. Amen. Amen. Questions? Microphone? You want to turn it on? All right, tap on it and see if it's on.
I wanted to say that today, when the Lord was showing me that every single word and detail of his instructions were life and death, absolute, I buried my face in my hands and I went, Lord, why am I not dead? Why aren't I dead? I should be. And I repented, but my heart wasn't lifted in hope until I heard this message tonight and I realized that he was preparing me to hear this. So I wanted to say that.
Amen. Amen. Anyone else? We are done then. If y'all help put up the fort, Jackie has a comment. Announcement. Jackie has announcements. Would you come up here, please?
Okay. Just wanted you to keep Carol in your prayers. She had a day surgery today to remove some of the cancer cells out of her bladder. And so apparently it went really, really well. And she's home and resting and everything. So just keep her in your prayers that she'll have a speedy recovery from that. And then work day next Tuesday here for Proverbs, if you're available, that would be great. We'll probably start early in the morning because we'll only have one day to accomplish everything since Monday is Labor Day. So
is next week Proverbs week?
Next Saturday.
Next Saturday. So I assure you there's lots of other things you can help tackle over here next week in the way of Proverbs.
And if you have not gone, seen the new website that we've made, please go on there and look at it. But then also, if y'all would go ahead and we're asking all the ladies to put in a blog, to put a comment to the blog that's in there. So just go to the blog page, scroll down to where it says comment, and it's a little bitty box at the bottom of that blog part. The new website looks a little bit different, so but it's a little easier to also to put in a comment. So please do that, because it really will help the women that are maybe coming to the website for the first time, or hearing about Proverbs for the first time. It will help them see what they can expect and what has blessed other women. So thank you for those of you who have done that. But if you haven't done that, if you would, that'd be great.
Amen. Thank you for reminding us of that. And Carol, get well soon if you're watching.
Yes.
Please forgive us. We forgot you were having surgery today.
I talked to her today, too.
We love you guys. Thank you for joining us. And that's all, folks. I'm not going to do the Edip tart.